really exciting to see you all here tonight. This is going to be a wonderful talk, and we're going to have time for interaction and questions and comments, and I'm just so delighted to see you all. The Foard Lecture is really one of the longest traditions in the school, and it's a time when faculty, staff, students, alumni from all over the school come together with friends of the school, with members of the public, and we get to think and focus on a particular topic and idea for an evening. And what a wonderful luxury that is. We're so glad to have one of our own, Dr. Richard Vinroot Jr., here tonight to deliver the Foard Lecture. We're also going to present two very important awards, and we'll say more about that in a minute. First, there are several groups here tonight that I want to recognize, and I'm not going to name everybody, but I just want to point out a few people. We're very glad to have Dr. Jeffrey Engel, our state health director, and many local health directors here tonight. Would you all raise your hands if you're local health directors? These are really important people in the state. And we just had a meeting. We brought together a number of people from the school with local health directors and Jeff, and we talked about how we can serve more together, even though we're in a time of great financial crisis. And I think we all have the same goals of improving the health of North Carolinians. We also want to recognize the Vinroot family and friends who traveled from Charlotte and New Orleans to be here tonight. We're especially pleased that Rich's parents, Richard and Judith Vinroot, and his sisters, Laura Vinroot Poole and Katie Vinroot O'Brien, are here. So thank you very much. And if you look around, you'll notice a number of people wearing ribbons, and they reflect members of our school's Public Health Foundation Board, our Advisory Council, our Alumni Governing Board, endowment donors who make professorships, scholarships, fellowships, and special funds possible, members of our Rosenau Society who provide really critically needed support for challenges and opportunities, and right now we have a lot of both. Members of our Cornerstone Society who support our buildings, and members of the Girard Society who have made plans to support the school over the long term. So thank you all for everything you do for the school. We wouldn't be the top public school of public health and second overall without your generosity. So thank you very much. Now, I'd like to call on Priscilla Guild, who's a graduate of our biostatistics department, former president of our alumni association, and current member of the alumni governing board, to present the Harriet Hilton Barr Award. Priscilla, thank you very much.
Thank you. You're welcome. Thank you very much, Barbara. I'm so pleased to have been able to chair the Awards Committee for the Alumni Association this year. It was a wonderful experience. We had many impressive applicants, again, to choose from. For those of you who didn't know Bernie Greenberg and Harriet Barr, without them, you might not have had an Alumni Association. And I want to give just a little bit of background on that. And I won't go over my 3 minutes. After founding the Department of Biostatistics, and chairing it for more than 20 years, Bernie Greenberg became Dean of the School of Public Health in 1972. I first met him as a student when he was chair of the department. He was a world-renowned statistician and an even better public health practitioner. When Bernie became dean, he quickly realized that in order to have a great school of public health, he had to involve the alumni. He started by forming the Public Health Fund, which was the precursor for our current Public Health Foundation, and realized that you couldn't ask alumni to give to the school if you weren't willing to involve them in the school. So with that was the beginning of the Alumni Association. He had known Harriet Barr as a faculty member in health behavior and health education for a number of years and realized that she was the perfect person to lead this effort. So Harriet became the first director of the Alumni Association, and became the first director of the Alumni Association and was director until she retired in 1994. She became Assistant Dean of Alumni Affairs in 1983. The endowed professorships that the professorship in Bernie's name came about because when Bernie asked the Alumni Association, he said the thing he needed most in the School of Public Health was some way to recognize his faculty. It was at a time when there were very few endowed professorships or other ways to recognize faculty, and that was the beginning of the Bernie Greenberg Endowment Fund fundraising activities. Now on to the Barr Award. In 1975, the Alumni Association presented its first Distinguished Service Award. When Harriet retired, the Alumni Association named that award for her. It is presented to an alumnus who has demonstrated commitment and service to public health through achievements in leadership, innovation, experimentation, and collaboration. I am pleased to announce that this year's recipient is Dr. Peter Kolsky. Dr. Kolsky is a graduate of the Department of Environmental Sciences and Engineering. He has worked extensively overseas to improve engineering services and in underdeveloped countries, and is currently a senior water and sanitarian specialist working for Latin America and the Caribbean regions for the World Bank. In addition, he has continued to give generously of his time to environmental sciences and engineering students at the Gillian School of Global Health as a mentor, speaker, and fundraiser. Your program has a more detailed description of why he is so deserving of this award. When I spoke with him, he was thrilled to have received the award and was very disappointed that he already had a trip to Belize on his calendar for this time. Now, he said to me, normally when he has these trips, he doesn't wish that they were canceled because they're so hard to schedule, but that he's never 100% sure he's going until the day before he goes. And in this case, he hoped it was canceled, but I gather it wasn't because he is not here. He will receive this award later in the spring when he's here to give a lecture for the ESE department and receive another award, I believe, from that department. Now I'm pleased to introduce Dr. John Paul, who will present the Bernard G. Greenberg Alumni Endowment Award. John and I first met when we were directors of the Alumni Board many years ago. He's worked for quite a while in Research Triangle Park for Research Triangle Institute and Glaxo Wellcome, and is currently a clinical associate professor in the Department of Health Policy and Management.
Thank you, Priscilla, and good evening. The Bernard G. Greenberg Alumni Endowment Award has been given annually since 1986 to a current faculty member in the School of Public Health who demonstrates the highest excellence in the areas of research, teaching, and service. The Greenberg Award is the highest recognition given by the school's more than 16,000 living alumni. The award recipient is chosen each year by representatives of the Alumni Board as well as current faculty selected by the dean. The Greenberg Award was established in Dean Greenberg's memory the year after he died and has been supported generously by the Greenberg family and many, many alumni. I am honored to have known Dean Greenberg, albeit briefly, when I was a graduate student. I still have the short, personal, handwritten note that he took the time to write me, a lowly graduate student, following just a brief interaction at an APHA annual meeting. The recipient of this year's Greenberg Award is Professor Bill Zellman. Bill received his PhD in sociology from the University of Washington and his accounting degree and CPA at the University of Denver. Bill came to Chapel Hill and joined the then Department of Health Administration in 1978, coincidentally the same year I began as a master's student. I was enrolled in one of Bill's first classes. Frankly, I remember very little from that fall of my first year. I do, however, vividly remember Bill's class and engaging teaching style. In my first midterm examination, which as it turns out was quite a wake-up call, I would fear to have to retake that midterm today. I did make it through the class, however, and tremendously valued the experience. Bill has maintained his excellence in teaching all the, may I say, many years since. But more than just being a good teacher, Bill has been an outstanding and ongoing mentor to so many students and alumni. Bill's values, service, and example have been a beacon for many of us and truly exemplify the values of Dean Greenberg. Bill continues to be the master teacher in our department and school, and currently is the principal investigator of the only Gillings Innovation Lab devoted to teaching and learning. Bill continues to be a great help and inspiration to me and his many other colleagues in the department and school. I'm honored today to present on behalf of the Department of Health Policy and Management, the Gillings School of Global Public Health, and the school's 16,000 living alumni, the 2011 Bernard G. Greenberg Alumni Endowment Award to Professor Bill Zellman.
I would love to have his deep voice. Thank you so much, JP, and thanks to the Alumni Association for giving me this award in Bernie's name. As JP mentioned, Bernie was my first dean when I came here in 1978, and many knew him then as an international scholar and certainly a leader in the School of Public Health, but I just knew him as a warm and welcoming dean to a new faculty member, and that was a real honor. Since then, I've learned what a wonderful human being was and how many lives that he touched. And to receive this award in Bernie's name on this occasion as I come to the end of my career, and that it's being given by the Alumni Association, and especially because it's being presented by John Paul, it makes this evening very special and makes the award very special. And I thank you. I was told to limit my remarks to 3 minutes. That's very hard for a professor to do, and it's very hard for someone like me that has so many thanks to give to so many people that have been very dear and valuable to me along the way. So my apologies to those that I won't be able to thank tonight, but there will be other occasions, and I look forward to those. First, let me thank my family. They're down here in the front. My wonderful wife, Janet, she's the bedrock of our family. She's been my wife for 44 years and worked with my career all the way through. Been wonderful support. My two children, Josh and Stacy, who are both here, they're the source of so much of the joy in my life, so much of the pride in my life. They're both Carolina graduates. It's nice to have them come in from out of town tonight. Let me also introduce my mother, Betty Zellman. She is here. She's going to be 101 years old in about a month, and she is the source. For any intellectual interest I have, she is the source. She still reads biographies, she still reads histories, she works on the computer, and always wants to talk about those things. I would appreciate very much if you see her afterwards that you don't say anything to her. She thinks you're all here tonight to see me win this award. So don't tell her otherwise, please. Since time is so short, let me thank the deans, all of the deans that I've had. I've had wonderful deans and wonderful chairs, and it's been a very supportive and nurturing environment that I've had. I would just like to thank those that are supporting my work now. And Barbara has been very generous with the school's resources, the Gill Innovation Labs, who are funding some of my work now, and Peggy Leet, who's my chair, and I'm very sorry that circumstances are such she couldn't be here tonight. She's a very dear person and a wonderful chair. Let me finish by again thanking the alumni. My family knows that nothing is more rewarding to me, other than my family and an occasional good round of golf, nothing is more rewarding to me than working with our students. We have wonderful students. We're a top school. We have top students. And I'd just like to give a quick thank you to a very special group of alumni. All of them have gone on to have their own successful careers, but they've also given back to public health and they've given back to the school. And on tonight's occasion, let me recognize that they've given an awful lot to me. So whatever the students say that they've gotten, I've gotten so much more. Let me just recognize Mark Merrill. I didn't see where Mark went, but Mark is here. Fred Brown is here. And I appreciate both of you coming from out of town. Bob Gresham texted me just before tonight and said he had his wife was stuck in Atlanta and he had to babysit. I said he has his priorities straight, so he can't be here, but I do appreciate so much. Steve Garfinkel and, of course, John Paul. John was one of my very first students and now is a valued friend and colleague. And so a very special thanks to all of you. Since my 3 minutes is almost up, I timed it. Since my 3 minutes is almost up, let me end with a quote from Carolina's most famous academic, if I could. He was quoted just last week in the Daily Tar Heel and nationally on television. Now, he said it with a little more southern accent than I will, but he said, "I wouldn't trade my kids for anybody. It's been an unbelievable ride, and they've been an unbelievable group of kids, and they have really made coaching fun." Well, I say, Roy, in regard to my career and my students, that's an understatement. It's been a wonderful ride, and thank you. I am really honored tonight and humbled by this award. Thank you very much.
Well, congratulations to both Pete and Bill. And I first started hearing about his impact on students when I was at the health club one day, and one of my colleagues and a former student just started spontaneously doing a testimonial for him, and everything she said was true, and I've really appreciated learning and watching you, Bill. Well, now I'd like to just tell you a little bit about Dr. Richard Vinroot Jr. His roots in North Carolina go deep. His parents met while students at Carolina. His father, Richard, was a Moorhead Scholar and a Tar Heel basketball player under Coach Dean Smith. Rich, the younger, grew up in Charlotte, where his father held various political offices, including mayor, and his mother, Judith, taught school. Dr. Vinroot got his bachelor's degree in Southern History from UNC in 1992. I think that's good training for everything that came after, and went back to Charlotte, where he took a job as a portfolio manager. He had always wanted to be a doctor, like his grandfather, but something held him back. His parents convinced him that he should try, and in 2000, he came back to UNC for medical school. But medical school wasn't the last step. He was still searching for, I think, the right thing, what was really him. And he came to our school, and in 2004, he graduated with an MPH from our Public Health Leadership Program and an MD from the UNC School of Medicine. We're both proud to claim him. During his emergency medicine residency in New Orleans, Dr. Vinroot found his true calling, his mission. He was staying with friends when Hurricane Katrina struck in 2005. His friends evacuated, but Rich headed for the nearest hospital, not even his own. Conditions were primitive. We were talking earlier about North Carolina can be as primitive and in as much need as many global health settings, and that was certainly true for New Orleans at that time. No electricity, no water, no anesthesia, just the need to intubate a patient on whom he refused to give up, and his hands. He kept the woman alive so she could be transferred to Houston, and then he helped the other 200 patients left behind at Touro Hospital. Rich stayed in New Orleans until all the patients were evacuated, and then he joined a search and rescue team. Thus began a career that has taken him to enough hotspots to compete with Sanjay Gupta. I first got to know Dr. Vinroot through emails he sent after Hurricane Katrina and the ordeal there. I was moved by his bravery and commitment to save lives in the midst of flood, loss, and disorder. Since then, he's also experienced earthquake and war. Thus, the title of tonight's talk. Dr. Vinroot practices medicine in several Ochsner emergency rooms in the New Orleans area. He understands that public health occurs not just in the clinic, but also on the streets, where he works with homeless men, women, and children as a public health doctor. In addition to his medical work, he's a member of the university's Board of Visitors and our school's alumni board. And he's also this year's winner of the Public Health Leadership Program's Kaluzny Award, which recognizes distinguished leadership. So after Rich talks, Peggy Bentley, who's our Associate Dean for Global Health and Professor of Nutrition, will lead a question and answer session. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Vinroot.
to be out here for 3 minutes too, right? Dean? You want to wait? I think they're going to do so.
You can either put that in your pocket or clip it to your belt.
Hey, I'm Rich Vinroot, as you all now know, and I'm an ER doctor in New Orleans. I never thought in any manner I would ever be speaking here in front of people, and especially you all here in this venue. I associate this venue with something. Actually, I'll tell you a quick story, which my mom's going to be mad about, but I associate this venue, being the Friday Center, with me being a college student 18 years ago and in the process of being initiated into a men's society. I was stripped naked and taken down towards Durham and expected to get back here. And I found a lady that gave me a ride back and dropped me at the gas station that was here right around the corner. And finally, I remember walking by, and that this was a field. This was not this nice facility. But what's really, and so that's what I associate with, but what's really sad is that I did a speech at the School of Medicine a year ago, and my initial start of my speech was the same thing. But it was Memorial Hall, where I had been naked 20 years before. And so I'm probably the only speaker you're going to ever have that his only association with the venues he's speaking in is he was naked there 20 years ago. It's an honor to be here. I do know there are about 400 of you here, because every day Jerry has told me there are 400, and that's a lot of people, and it looks like more than 400 from here. I called my dad the other day, and he said, "Well, how are you doing? Are you gonna, you ready? You gonna do well up there?" And I said, "I guess so. I don't know. There are 400 or so people," and he said, "I know it's gonna be a lot of people." And I said, "Well, I hope, you know, and I hope there's nobody under 18. I said, I hope I don't make an ass of myself up there." And my dad goes, "Well, you've done that plenty of times, so don't worry too much about that." And I think that's probably, it was funny. I mean, you have to know a little about me. I was a menace to public health, I think, at times in my life. I made a lot of bad decisions as an 18-year-old, as a 22-year-old, and then I made a very good decision at 25, and I decided to go back to medical school. I made an even better decision a few years later when I decided to become a MD, MPH, and come into the program at the Global Health Institute, School of Global Health, to become a MPH. Those were great decisions, and I could not be here today talking to you all if it was not for those institutions that allowed me to obtain the credentials and training to be here. I am Carolina product from head to toe. I am an undergrad, a master's program, and my doctorate. And so I'm lucky, and Chapel Hill has allowed me to become who I wanted to become. And I don't think a lot of people, maybe I'm naive, but I truly believe I had a picture of who I was going to become, and I have closely become that person. I wanted to be a physician who was mobile and that was efficient and hopefully valuable to somebody, and I think that hopefully I've become that person. And that's exciting. Some people ask me, why did I do the MPH program? I was in the process of becoming an emergency room doctor, and I always tell the story that I was in Malawi as a young man, younger, before I went to medical school, and I met a guy who was a doctor who had an MPH, and I said, "Well, what do you do with that, and what is that?" And he said, "Well, it actually is very important, and the Malawi government does not care about my MD. They don't care about me seeing patients. They care about my MPH. And I'm hired by the Malawi government because of my MPH. And that's when I really learned that it was an important thing or important training to have as a physician. This title today was given to me by the School of Public Health, so if you don't like what I talk about, it is not my fault. But I have no agenda. I'm not an academic, and I am not a politician. I'm going to tell stories briefly about what I've done and where my master's in public health fits into all this. Soon after I finished my residency for medical school here, I went to do my MPH. I stayed an extra year, which was very unorthodox, to obtain the MPH, which I did not want to leave without. But after that, I went to New Orleans. And New Orleans is a funny place. And when you say to people you're a doctor in New Orleans, they look at you like they probably look at somebody when he says, I'm a politician in the Congo. It doesn't make sense all the time. I mean, New Orleans is a screwed up place. And Louisiana is just as screwed up. People go around with their shirts and bumper stickers that say Louisiana, third world and proud of it. Which kind of says, it's an ideal place for a person to go and practice medicine, learn medicine, and practice public health. We're 50th in infant mortality. We're 50th in overall health of our population. We're 50th in life expectancy. But we do beat North Carolina in a few. We're first in STDs. We're first in obesity. So we do have some things that New Orleans, Louisiana is good at. And if Louisiana is a third world country, well, New Orleans is a fourth world country. Because it is an absolute hot mess. And every day I realize that as I live in this community. It's got a lot of culture and it's an interesting place, but it definitely has its issues because of poverty, because of inadequacy of education, bad politics, no economics, and then decadence that you can see in no other city in the United States. We also read recently we're the murder capital of the United States. We have 10 times the murder rate of anybody else in of the average murder rate in the United States. I remember being at training, where I trained at Charity Hospital, which is the second oldest facility in the country, in a very, very interesting place. And a lot of doctors are familiar with Charity because it's produced more doctors than any other hospital in the country. But whereas probably Chapel Hill has had, I don't know, you probably had 10 gunshots in, I don't know, 6 months. We would get 10 gunshots in a shift, and I'm in an 8-hour shift, not even a 12-hour one. And Charity is a true knife and gun club, and it was an interesting place to learn how to be a doctor. We still, when I went there, we still had wooden wheelchairs, which we do still have. There's one company in the country that makes wooden wheelchairs for Charity Hospital because you can't steal them. If you're seen with a wooden wheelchair, you know where you got it from. We also had wards. We had wards like they were in the 30s. I mean, and this is 7 years ago. We had wards that had fans that and plastic sheets between beds of 20 and 30 patients. And this is in America. So it was an interesting place to train. I always remember the first day I got there. This is a great idea of what I went through. The first day I showed up, a guy came in who had been shot in the head. It had bounced off his skull and he was living. And we did a CT scan of his head. There was no brain injury. He just had a chip out of his skull. And so I had him in the bed and I went to my attending. I said, well, I need to find out who I'm going to put this gentleman in to admit him to. And he goes, admit him? Wash that wound out and discharge him. So I still laugh that Charity Hospital is probably the only place in the country where you treat gunshot wounds to the head with water and discharge. So I thought I was going to be there for 4 years and go away, but soon afterwards I ended up, something happened that kept me there, and even though it didn't happen at the end of those 4 years, it is what has probably kept me in New Orleans and will probably keep me there for good, and it was Hurricane Katrina. In 2005 it hit. I stayed behind, not because I was thought that I was going to be a great part of that they needed me. I didn't do it because I thought that I was going to be some big hero. I did it because I was dumb, and I did not know that the hurricane was coming because I didn't have a TV. I did it because I was impatient. I didn't want to wait in a line in Mississippi with a bunch of cars driving somewhere to go stay. And I was naive. I didn't think it was going to hit. So it hit, and that was, and it was interesting. I mean, the hurricane is what everybody talks about, and that was the least of our issues. The big issues came, obviously, with the water the next day. And then I did make a good decision. I made a decision to stay because at that point I realized I might be of service. My house was looted. It was not flooded. And so I did go and make myself to another hospital where I was able to hopefully help out some folks. I worked for 4 days in the city. I went to Baton Rouge for a day. I worked with FEMA. I worked in the Superdome. I worked at the airport. I did a lot of different things, going into houses with the military, looking for bodies, and it was a 30-day experience that most people probably couldn't get in their lifetime. And so it was wonderful training, and I don't want to belittle, and it was a sad experience. It was a bad experience, but it probably made me a better doctor. And from an ER standpoint, it was an interesting experience, and it was something that you can't read in books and nobody can stand in front of you and lecture about in order to teach you. I was perfect, I guess, for it. I'm much to my mother's chagrin, I'm single. I don't have any pets. I didn't have much of a house or a family there that I was worried about. I had lived in bad environments before in other countries. So in the end, it was a relatively interesting experience for me, and I didn't have all the issues to deal with that a lot of my fellow population did. After that, though, the real issue was the recovery. It was not the acute phase. And so after the cameras left and after the electricity came back on, it was time to take care of the issues. And a lot of those issues that developed, as you can imagine, I mean, it was a garrisoned community. So I'm probably one of the only people here that has ever lived in America, in a city in America, that was garrisoned and occupied. Military convoys throughout the streets. We had checkpoints. We lived in this environment. We slept with guns in order to because of the fear of not knowing what was going to happen next. And this went on for months. We practiced medicine in a convention center. I practiced medicine in a tent. I practiced medicine in a department store. Medicine and medical care totally was disrupted, and we were forced to evolve and change the way of thinking and the way we practice medicine, or learned medicine for that matter, to serve the population. Emergency medicine doctors became really the distributors of medicine. Over 1,000 doctors left, and so it was people, residents like me and other doctors that stayed that were usually of emergency medicine because the practices were gone that were able to do this. And as you can imagine, public health helped me because it made me think about some of the issues that were to be expected, such as depression, such as alcohol and drug abuse. Wound issues, wound care, injuries from cleaning up debris, but other things that were even more important. We had people from North Carolina coming down there that were guys that had grown up in Robeson County or Greene County that were diabetics that were clearing the streets, and they didn't bring their doctors with them. And so we became doctors for those that came to help us out. And so chronic disease became a big issue in that environment. Like I said, many were not able to alter their roles, and I was. And I think that in the end, the hurricane and the subsequent months and years, actually, because we are still recovering from that experience, was beneficial to me. And I swear to it, and I would never say this to somebody that lost their house in the hurricane, but I would always say that the hurricane gave me much more than it took from it. And it will continue to affect all the decisions I make the rest of my life. So, after I finished my residency, I decided I needed to do something else. I'd been there for 4 years, and I decided I wanted to do something a little bit more unique, and so then go and take a job. I was offered a job at the Ochsner Clinic, and decided to. They were kind enough to say, "We will hold this job until you come and get it." And so I went and decided to join Doctors Without Borders or MedSans Sans Frontières, which was a wonderful thing to be able to do. They accepted me. Interestingly, I always said I was going to be a doctor in Africa, and I learned this years ago. My mom and dad sent me to Africa when I was 19 years old. Mom sold it to me as if it was something that would be very, very good for you, and this would be a wonderful experience. I know why she sent me to Africa. They were very worried about my behavior, and they found the one place that if I did mess up, it would never get back to Charlotte or the papers. So I went and lived in Ghana, and I had a woman that I cared for there that really made me think to myself that if I ever have a chance to do this, I'll come back and be a doctor in Africa. And I got to do that. I guess kept a promise to myself that 20 years later I fulfilled. So I was a TB HIV doctor. So I took care of tuberculosis and HIV in a slum called Mathari. Mathari is a dreadful slum. There are two slums in Kenya, and Mathari is a bad one. I went and heard Rai Barcott the other night, and Rai is this very famous Carolina alum who has done a heck of a lot. And the other slum over there, which is called Kibera, it's bigger, and it's across the town. And I kind of wanted to stand up and say, "Hey, Rai, I bet my slum's poorer than yours." But I felt that would be unprofessional. But it's a true rough place. I mean, 500,000 people living in an area 4 miles by 8 miles, probably. 75% of the population made their income from illegal means, such as prostitution, illegal alcohol distilling, or gangsterism. 25% were HIV positive, and half those people had TB. Families of four lived on a quarter a day. So it is a place that you will pray to God you will never have to live in, and thank God every day that you don't. My nurses are so funny. They come. I'm not a very smart doctor, but I obviously am in the hospital a lot. And they say, Dr. Vinroot, you sure don't get alarmed too much. And I tell them, I say, I don't get alarmed too much because I lived in a slum for a year, and it is awful. So you know, nothing could be worse than that. So it's been wonderful, and it's been healthy for me, and it taught me a lot. And it was in this slum where I was able to be a pure doctor. I would go into people's shanties, I guess we could call them, and I was asked to, you know, we would carry people out of these things in different stages of disease, and we were able to take care of people in a way that you don't always get to take care of them in this world today, in America, where we have so much technology and things are so specialized. So I got to be a real doctor, but it was my MPH that actually was very, very helpful, and my MPH allowed me to understand slum dynamics, and that means you need to think about things. You send somebody out with a packet of oral rehydration, you better hope they have water. You send them out with medicine that's going to end up being chronic, you better hope they have a source for medicine to continue that medicine. With regards to TB, there's six people living in a room as big as y'all's closet, and you guarantee that the other people are going to get TB, so you've got to think about those things. But it was beyond just disease and slum dynamics. It was also regionalism, and which helped us with diagnoses. A lot of people in the eastern part of Kenya had malaria. A lot of people in the western part of Kenya had HIV. The north, they came with a lot of malnutrition and lots of nutritional deficiencies. The cities, they had lots of drug and alcohol abuse. And to even make that smaller, you had to think about tribal issues. Samburu people from the north came in with a lot of these nutritional deficiencies. The folks from the eastern part of the country were primarily Muslim and had a lot less of a prevalence of HIV. The Somalis from northern Kenya and from Somalia had lots of drug-resistant TB because they had been in places where their treatment had been interrupted. I have an interesting story, which I remember. This is instituting my own public health when we had the Luo population in Obama is a Luo, and I don't mean, this is not politics, he is of a Luo descent. And the Luo, I don't mean to bring in more naked talk, but the Luo don't circumcise, and it's cultural. And they had a study that came out that said that if you didn't circumcise, that you were more prone to HIV. Well, this went on, and lots of talk went on, and they decided to come out and say, you need to get circumcised. And so people began thinking that if they were circumcised, and they didn't go into much, they just said, get circumcised, you won't get AIDS. Well, they didn't realize that a lot of people were going to go out and do that, and then they would go home with these incisions or these wounds that allowed them to be more of a vector if they already had HIV, more of a individual who would get HIV because of that, and somebody that promiscuity because they thought that all of a sudden they weren't going to get AIDS was much more easy. And so we had to go and identify the Luo that were going out and getting these circumcisions all of a sudden to do so, and I would not have done that or thought of that without my master's in public health. Following Kenya, I went back home to New Orleans where I went to work for the Oxford Clinic. I was there for about 10 months, and I was getting exhausted with treating some of the things that I was treating in my ER. I told a class today that I love America, and Americans are wonderful, but we are huge wimps. And we come into the ER for a lot of things that probably should not come into the ER for. And so all of a sudden, when this earthquake happened, a lot of people that do work in other countries, which I'm fortunate enough to be, I guess, one of those people, all know each other and there are a lot of contacts. And so I immediately started getting calls from organizations to come and work with them. I ended up going with a group called the Association of Haitian Human Development. So I went to Haiti. Interestingly, it wasn't the fact that I was an emergency room doctor or I had any language skills or had worked for Doctors Without Borders that made me valuable in Haiti. What made me valuable in Haiti is that I'd been to Haiti. Haiti makes Kenya look like Norway. It is absolutely out of control, and I remember that. And I tell people all the time, you have not traveled until you've crossed a border by foot in Haiti. It is scary, but it is also so dysfunctional. And I did that. And so I understood Haiti, I guess, to an extent, and was able to be effective in a place that really is so not effective. So I went to work with them. I flew from New Orleans to Miami, from Miami to Santo Domingo. I took a truck to an airfield and flew from that airfield to Port-au-Prince. From Port-au-Prince, I drove to another airfield, caught another plane down to Jacmel. From Jacmel, I took a truck into the mountains and went to work in La Vallée, Jacmel. It was a 40,000 area catchment of people that had no real health care. Jacmel was the other city that was hit, and so I ended up in this place with eight other doctors caring for a population that really had very little and was in the middle of an absolute terrible disaster. I realized that this was a different disaster very quickly. The aftershocks that continued, you didn't have to have been there to understand how bad it was, because you would look at the face of these individuals when an aftershock hit, and it was absolute terror on their faces. And they would run for cover, and they would be children as little 2-year-olds and adults at 60, and they would run like hell was behind them. And so I'll never forget. So I understood that. And then and the second thing, the scope of it. I was in a boarding house, staying in a boarding with several other doctors, and the man that served us every day, he was very depressed appearing, and didn't look. And of course, everybody was rather depressed, I guess. And a few days later, I learned they said, well, you know, he lost 8 family members in this thing. They can't find them. And this is within. I guess I was down there within 5 or 6 days of the thing. And they can't find anybody, these people, and they're probably all dead. And it wasn't just 8 like second cousins or brother-in-laws. He lost his wife, he lost his mother, he lost 2 daughters, and then he lost 4 other family members. And to be able to bear that cross and still come and bring me something to eat each day so I could keep serving was really remarkable, and put things in perspective. My MPH came into play there as well, because disasters are not the real world, and you change your practice when you are there, and so you have to think about those things, and the global health, my background allowed me to do that. You have to think about the injuries that you're going to come across, which a lot of crush injuries, a lot of post-traumatic stress, a lot of tropical ulcers secondary to injuries that occurred during this event. One thing I always think about, a boy who, and this is talking about just, and I dropped the ball on this one, but a boy came to me who had walked, 11-year-old boy, he had walked the 35 miles from Port-au-Prince to Jacmel to find his family. He'd been school there to find his mother, and his mother brought him back. And he'd been trapped in a house for 2 days, and he had a headache. And, of course, meningitis and it was an issue down there regardless, and so he had a fever, headache, and looked ill, and so I treated him for meningitis. He lasted about 4 days before the headache never went away. And finally, one night, his mother took him away, and I think my nurses told me that he probably went to go to a traditional doctor for treatment because the headaches weren't going away. Well, I learned a few days later as well that it probably wasn't meningitis. It was, again, probably post-traumatic stress, because not only had he been trapped into this house for 2 days, but he'd been trapped in that house with his sister, who had died next to her. So this child, 11-year-old, had gone and walked all this mileage and was probably just absolutely miserable. He wasn't sick. He was sad. Hopefully my training, but also the things that I learned here at the School of Public Health were helpful. And it's interesting. I went down there with 7 doctors, and there were a lot of specialists, and a lot of them had not done a lot of work. And this is something I'm complimenting the School of Public Health, but I was much better at this than they were. And within 3 days, all those doctors left and left me behind, because I was able to think, I think, about the fact that it wasn't just about, I didn't need to treat somebody's hypertension when they'd come out of a house that had been collapsed or diagnosed them with diabetes. It was much more important to, you know, lay the stethoscope on them and treat them with some Benadryl so they could sleep at night. So Haiti was a wonderful experience from a doctor standpoint. It was a sad experience from all other aspects. In closing, I am by far not the smartest doctor. My friends who are here will tell you that very quickly. I have had a lot of global experiences and domestic experiences that have hopefully made me more valuable and hopefully a better doctor. As I said earlier, I'm an ER doctor, and I work in six hospitals in New Orleans. They're all very different. I work in one down by the Gulf of Mexico. I work in one that's a very rural hospital. I work in one in the inner city and multiple other ones. A lot of people told me, they said, you're crazy. You're going to get an MPH and you're going to be an ER doctor. That's silly. That doesn't make any sense. But I disagree. I think that the ER is the face of the nation's healthcare because it's where the most dysfunction shows up, whether they be alcohol abuse, whether they be spousal abuse, whether they be people that shoot people, whether they be people that are uninsured and don't have access. And so I really get to see really how healthy our population is, and I get to hopefully make a difference because it's an unbelievable venue for public health. I drive my patients crazy. They come in with a sprained ankle, and I start asking them, did they finish high school? Do they have a job? Do they take care of their children? And I get involved. I mean, there's a social history, and an MD is kind of nice because it allows you to ask questions. It's a license to be a voyeur, and you ask all these questions, and I ask these questions, and they get out of there, and I don't know if any of them ever listen, but they get it from me, because I recognize that I got to live on this earth too, and if those people are messing up and misbehaving and are continuing to be unhealthy, then it's going to hurt me. So I continue to do those things in the ER. I'll continue utilizing this MPH in the globally. I'll continue using it with my homeless population. I'll continue using it, hopefully, in North Carolina. A lot of people that are MDs talk about the MPH being a secret handshake. And I think it's more of like a skeleton key. It really allows you access to other countries, other worlds, other places to practice medicine. And if we have more people that do this and that think this way, it will be a more healthy community. Because if South Carolina is more healthy, then we're going to be more healthy. If Bolivia is more healthy, then America is going to be more healthy. So I think that it's a discipline that will benefit all, whether you're a doctor, whether you're an engineer, whether you're a nurse. It has helped me. So thank you all very much. As we say in Kenya, Mazuri sana, Rafiki mimi. As we say in Haiti, Merci beaucoup, Zami Mwen. And as they say in New Orleans, thank you now, you heard me.
Rich, you're not done yet. I just want to thank Rich and wonderful talk, very inspirational, the life journey of Rich Vinroot Jr. so far, and very wonderful stories and gives meaning to why we have global in the name of our school. We talk about the local global connections and the importance of really understanding both. So it was just a wonderful talk for all of our alumni and friends who are here. We have time for questions. There are two microphones on each side of the room. And I invite you now to come and ask questions to Rich. And I know that students in particular, these stories of your experiences have been really meaningful the last 2 days in our school. And so I encourage the students to come up and ask questions of Rich.
Thank you again for sharing. My name is Jonathan Hedrick, and I'll be a first-year medical student at East Carolina starting in the fall. And I was curious, and this is sort of to lead off of her sort of statement about things globally, and a lot of these places where you go to work, safety speaking, they're not places that my mother, a lot of people's mothers would ever want to see their sons. The war in Kenya, the earthquakes, famines and slums, and gangsterism all over the place. And so my question is somewhat of a personal nature, and it's, are you ever afraid to go to these places? And if so, have you ever made decisions to go somewhere where there's a need that may be addressed that maybe you don't find yourself personally able to address? And if so, how do you make the decision and cope with it to not face need globally or anywhere for that matter that could be addressed when you may choose to serve yourself otherwise?
I mean, I think that, I mean, I've worked in, after I lived in Ghana, I went and lived in Kingston, Jamaica 2 years later, which was another dreadful place, but an interesting place. But I continue probably going to the places that I guess I should be much more thoughtful of my issues and the issues involved. And but I think that you evolve and decide whether or not places scare you or not. And I've had bad experiences, but I've been fortunate enough to not have any that are so bad. My mom, I think it drives her crazy, but I do these things, and she always tells me, she goes, be careful, and you know, she's always so worried that I'm doing sort of making not so good decisions. But I think you get used to it. You do it a couple times. It's almost like my Haiti talk. You go once and you survive it. You kind of realize that you can do this, and it's something that will be beneficial to you and to them.
Thanks.
No problem. Good luck at East Carolina. Med school's real fun. Yes, sir.
No matter what you do there, probably it's always going to be a 4x8 slump. And when you're gone, it's hard to know if you left any footprints. Whereas perhaps somewhere up the economic scale, it still might be somewhat desperate, but your efforts might count for more in the long run.
I understand. I don't think about, there's a bit of selfishness. I know I get a lot out of these experiences as well. So there, I go a lot because I know I'll hopefully be effective, helpful, but also I'll learn something from them. But I also do believe, and there's a Jewish saying that says you help one, you help a million. And I always think that's okay. So even if I go to that slum and if I affect one or two, somebody's going to be better off because of it. Next. Yes.
I'm a physician assistant that worked in ER, and I was last year in Jacksonville at the cancer chief. And I just want to testify to the fact that you were with the Saint Sans Frontier at some point. But Saint Sans Frontier was at the hospital a little higher on in Jacksonville, and we were working in the camp. And we were so blessed to have them in our back. It was all the bad kids went to them. So as a member of the Saint Sans Frontier, thank you.
They're a wonderful organization, and they're a lean, efficient group, and you're obviously French. I can hear you. Oh, she was just saying that there was a hospital. How lucky she was when she was working in Jacmel to have MSF and have one of their hospitals nearby and it does make a difference. It's an unbelievable organization. They have a lot of money. They have a lot of expertise, and they're good at this. And so I agree with you. They were very helpful, and we were able to send a lot of our worst cases to them. Yes.
Thank you very much for your presentation. One of the things that I appreciated that you were saying is how much our well-being depends upon the well-being of others, that when people in South Carolina are healthier, then we'll be healthier too, and in Haiti and so on. And I wonder if you have ideas of ways to help more people have that understanding, because in the United States, as you know, we have a very self-oriented ethos to some extent, not maybe in public health, but in many circles. And I think a lot more could be done for us as well as for the world if more people had the vision that you do of helping others to help ourselves.
Well, I think that that's one of the big, obviously, goals, and Peggy Bentley and I've discussed this, is making us all understand, whether you're a student here or whether you're a student at the School of Global Health, is to understand that global is local, and what's good for the world is good for us. And I think the most important thing is continue to produce people that are going to go out and do this think this way. And the school has obviously made, you know, not way beyond the change in the name. I mean, they have started thinking this way in a big way, and that makes a difference.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Thanks, Dr. Vinroot. I really enjoyed your talk. So all of your stories were about individuals and not populations, and I really appreciated your efforts to sort of remind us of the relevance of the MPH. But it still seems to me that the core of the talk was essentially a medical talk. So I'm wondering, what does it say about a school of public health when its premier annual talk is really a talk about medicine?
I blame them for giving me the title. I'm just a dumb doctor, I don't know. I mean, I think that I tried to weave my public health training into my experiences. I can only do so much. I am who I am because of my MD and my MPH. It just so happens that I'm not an administrator. I'm not a researcher. I am a doctor who takes care of individuals. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you again for your presentation. Can you tell us, please, how you became involved with Doctors Without Borders and how others could take advantage of the same opportunity?
Well, Doctors Without Borders began years ago as a break off of the Red Cross. When the Red Cross, during Biafra crisis in the 70s, the Red Cross was not talking about everything that they saw, and Doctors Without Borders evolved from that and realized that they were going to not only treat people but also let people know what exactly they were seeing. And it has evolved from an organization that was primarily doctors to an organization that is everybody, providers, whether and not just providers but also engineers. It's a very good organization. It's a very well-funded organization. It's a very well-known organization. And it frustrates a lot of other NGOs because of its ability to raise money very effectively and take care of people in an efficient manner. Anybody at this point could become a member if you are accepted, and 20% of the people that are employed by them at this point are doctors. So it's no longer, it should be called Providers Without Borders, because it's not, the charter only has 20% of those that are doctors. So there are nurses, there are midwives, there are everybody. And so really all it takes is applying and having them interview you. It's about a 6-month process or so to be interviewed. They screen pretty carefully, and then you end up going and being accepted. You look like you'd be a great candidate.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir.
Yes, thank you very much for your presentation. It was an excellent talk, and also you weren't stupid to stay in New Orleans. You were brave, because I was in Dallas, Texas, and we saw exactly what went on and saw a lot of the refugees from New Orleans. My question is, your comment about your role as an emergency department physician, emergency medicine physician, is very encouraging. The types of questions that you're asking your patient is fabulous. I wonder if you could comment about whether or not you see your professional society, you know, College of Emergency Medicine Physician, residency training program, starting to populate their academic program with consideration of the role that the emergency department physicians play, because you are right, I'm a hospital guy, and we are the emergency department is the front door of the healthcare system right now. And are you at all encouraged that perhaps your specialty society and your training will get into thinking about public health issues from a not just an episode of care?
I appreciate that question, and I thank you for saying those nice things. I don't know if, you know, I come from a little bit of a different world because of this MPH. I also come from a little bit of a different world because of my parents, and I think that I thought a little bit differently when I went into this environment about trying to make a little bit of a difference that was not just dealing with the present complaint. A lot of my colleagues think I'm nuts. I mean, they think I'm crazy, and they think you're wasting your breath. And so I don't know. I do think that at where we are in New Orleans, there's lots of need. And so we do have a lot of our residents at LSU manning homeless clinics. And so they're starting to think that way, but obviously New Orleans is probably unique because of what we've gone through. So I hope so. I hope we will make some changes.
We have time for these last two questions.
Thank you so much for being here.
Yes, ma'am.
As a student, there's often a temptation to want to be able to do more, to jump out there, to get on a plane, to go somewhere and get your hands dirty. But there's also this awareness that there's a lot of learning left to do and a lot of training that needs to happen before you're fully equipped to help people. So what advice do you have for students who have that passion but need to sometimes hold back to get that training but also keep their passion alive?
I think the main thing is to, as you're a student, to continue to involve yourself in environs that you think you would like to go to. So there's so many. I started out by going to Africa as a 19-year-old, and I then went to Jamaica, and then I continued to do things, whether it be in Haiti, whether it be, I went back to, when I was a medical student, I went back and worked in an emergency room in Kingston. I just kind of continued to find ways to do a little bit different of different things that would keep my interest and keep my skills, I guess, or better my skills at doing it. And so I think the main thing is to search out venues where you can continue to do it while you're still studying. There are plenty of them, you don't have to be a doctor, you don't have to be a medical student, you don't have to be a nursing student, you don't have to be a MPH student. There's plenty of need in any of these short-term humanitarian efforts to make a difference. Yes, ma'am.
Hey there. I appreciate your time tonight. I thought your speech was wonderful. I want to backtrack a little bit. One of the gentlemen that came up here asked why your talk wasn't more about the actual program, and I work with a specialist at a university hospital in the area, and I think the interesting thing about you that is totally different from the specialists that I work with is that, you know, the specialist, you only treat one thing, and even if you have something outside of that thing that affects the one thing you treat, you're either going to treat it or you're not. So, you know, if I see a patient that comes in that has a knee problem that's surgical and they have diabetes, well, somebody else can handle their diabetes. I just handle a knee. So, you know, I have to appreciate the fact that you are even able to look outside of a head wound or a scar or, you know, a crush injury and look at all the other sources of a patient's problem that maybe was even bigger than what you saw right there in front of your face. So I think that that's a strength that you have that was probably brought with the MPH program. And so I salute you for that. My question is, the MPH program seems to have a very large social work component, if you will. I think that you have the ability to look into the public and choose how your education and your beliefs are going to affect them. Did you see any social workers, or did you have any direct contact with anyone that was in a social work field? And if you did, were you able to gather together with them in order to educate and influence the public?
I guess I'll address both the things you said. One thing with regards to what you earlier said about the ER, one thing I really realized early on and began thinking to myself was, if not me, then who? And if you think that way, it allows you to do the things that I do, because I don't think a lot of my patients are going to go see that specialist. So I'm kind of forced to think that it's me and it's up to me to treat a lot of these issues, because they're never going to see somebody by choice or by access. So thank you for appreciating that, that's why I do that. Secondly, yes, I didn't really tell you about my clinic in Africa. I had a drug-resistant TB clinic. I had a TB HIV clinic. I had a small ER. We had a solely HIV clinic, not combined or not co-infected. And lastly, we had a sex and gender-based violence clinic. And that's something that Doctors Without Borders has gotten very involved with, and that has to do with, obviously, sexual assault and the things that can happen in a lot of these countries, and really not just the assault itself, really what happens afterwards. And so my roommate was a French social worker, and that's what she did. And I bet you that there are, now that as Doctors Without Borders continues to evolve and realize that this is important, you'll see more of those folks there, not only for issues such as gender-based violence, but also post-event, whether it be a hurricane, whether it be an earthquake, whether it be the North Sudanese fighting with the Southern Sudanese, dealing with post-traumatic stress and those issues. So you do see a role, and they understand that.
Good. Thank you very
much. Yes, ma'am.
Rich, thank you very much. You know, Naaman, as I was thinking about your question, and I think that it used to be that people really made this bright line distinction between public health and medicine, and, you know, public health focuses on populations and medicine focuses on individuals. And I think a lot of what has changed over the years is that we have this idea that you could bring the lens of public health to being a physician and see the population perspective. And I think Rich really exemplifies that, but I'd like to think that there are lots of us in public health who can bring the population perspective when we look at when you look at a medical problem or a risk factor or an environmental problem. And so I think one of the great things about our school is that we've really fostered that kind of integration, and it makes much, much stronger public health and hopefully stronger medicine. And based on a conversation we had earlier with health department directors, and I think Rich said this also, there are lots of problems in this state to focus on, and there are lots of parts of this state that are very poor and very needy, and Rich has spent a lot of his time in this country as well as out of this country, so I hope you got the local, global message as well. Rich, thank you so much. We have a small gift to thank you for being here and telling us about your life and your commitments, and thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you all.
And before closing, I'd really like to thank Jerry Salick, who is really the ultimate planner for helping to bring this together, and also our external affairs and communication staff who really made this event possible. Thank you for being with us tonight. We have a really nice reception out in the foyer, and I hope you'll come and have a chance to talk to our speaker and to each other, and come back next year, April 17th, for our next Foard Lecture. So thank you so much.